Should be online now. Damon fixed it.
I'm fine.
Okay, bowling fans, how we doing? Let me hear you. All right. We're getting close here. Our group stepladder final is going to start momentarily. The athletes are warming up. All three of them are out here now, but for about the next couple of minutes, they'll be that way. And then at 5 till the hour, the high qualifier will step to the side. It'll leave the pair for our number 3 and number 4 qualifiers. But before we get started, I do have some dignitaries in the crowd that I'd like to recognize. First, we'll start with the Nebraska USBC State President, John Haney. Where's John at? John, down there. Thank you for your support. Wave to the crowd. Appreciate everything you do for us and for USBC. Thank you. Also, the Nebraska President-elect, Linda Wilson. Where's Linda at? Is she here or did she scoop? She left? Okay. She's gone. Well, Linda, thank you as well. Also, from Ebonite International, Mr. Randy Schicker. I'm not sure where he went to. Randy, where you at? Nope. He stepped to the side as well. All right, I'm 0-2 here. I'd also like to recognize our proprietor here. Without his hard work and dedication, this event doesn't happen. Mr. John Lucido. John, behind the counter, thank you, and thank you so much. Thank you once again, because just not possible. All the volunteers, the folks in back, the snack bar, everybody who kept this fed this week, thank you to everybody. Appreciate it. Thank you. All right, at this time, it's my pleasure to introduce to our players that are going to put on the show for you here. On lanes 25 and 26, our number 4 qualifier, an All-American at Pikeville University from Wichita, Kansas, April Ellis. Her opponent in that opening match, 12-time member of the Colombian national team, 5-time Colombian national champion. From Colombia, Rocio Restrepo. And the winner of that match will go on to face our number 2 qualifier, currently stepping to the side. She rolled 300 earlier this week as well. 13-time member of the Mexican national team, 2-time Mexican national champ, Sandra Gongora. Looks like we're about 5 minutes away here. Our number 2 qualifiers have stepped to the side. On lanes 21 and 22, let me introduce these group of professionals here. Our number 4 qualifier captured the 2013 Queens Championship, 10 years a member of Team Latvia. Please welcome Diana Zavjalova. Her opponent in the opening match, 1 PWBA title to her credit, the reigning PWBA Rookie of the Year. From Grand Prairie, Texas, Stefanie Johnson. The winner of that match will go on to face our number 2 qualifier here. 12 titles in all, 6 majors, 2 Queens, 4 United States Women's Open Championships, the reigning PWBA Player of the Year, Liz Johnson. All right, bowling fans, we're getting just a little bit closer here, so hang in there just a few minutes. We will begin our matches. Thank you. Bowlers, you have 1 minute to go in practice time. 1 minute remaining. Strikes they're probably going to throw out there. So pick a favorite, cheer them on.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the finals of the 2016 Pepsi PWBA Lincoln Open. Got a great group stepladder finals here for you. Tonight, got a great guest in the booth with me, Aaron McCarthy.
Hello.
Good evening, Aaron. How are you?
Great. How are you?
I don't know if it's evening yet. Not quite evening yet here. It is on the East Coast. But great stepladder finals. And you made the cut here into the round of 32. You got to bowl on these conditions.
I did.
And 36-foot pattern. What did you see out there?
It was kind of interesting. It didn't play like your typical short pattern. There weren't a lot of people that were to play right up the gutter. It was almost played more like a medium pattern, especially towards the end. There's more people playing a little bit left to right, which you don't typically see on these shorter patterns.
So April Ellis is going to get us started off here. She tended to bowl really well early, it seemed like, so you would think she would have a good look here in the stepladder.
I would definitely agree.
And April taking on Rocio Restrepo, and Stefanie Johnson taking on Diana Z. Diana has had a couple of heartbreaking events where she led qualifying and then just narrowly missed the TV show, and she said, I think I'm going to go try to go from the bottom up this time.
Well, it's kind of what she did to start the day.
Pulled a strong last couple of games to get in, but now bowling on the fresh, we'll see what her look looks like. Not sure what we've seen Diana balk quite a bit lately, but I don't know if that was the reason for that one.
Yeah, I'm not sure. She actually told me a few stops ago that it's almost like that she can't get her feet moving. Her mind is telling her to move her feet, but she physically can't move.
Yeah. She had the same. She said it was the week she got sick and started doing it, and then kind of got into her head.
Yeah.
But there were some fans taking their seats, and maybe that was. Usually she stops a little quicker than she did there.
Yeah.
Didn't seem to bother her, though, after she reset.
She typically throws good shots after she balks.
Now, is she throwing urethane?
No, I think that's the Dark Legend by Hammer.
Okay. See you. Little close there on the 2-8 conversion.
Those aren't always a gimme on these shorter patterns.
So pretty good contrast in styles in both of these matches. You've got Diana, who likes to go left to right a little bit more than Stephanie, and Rocio likes to go left to right a little more than April. What's your impression as far as who do you think that favors on the fresh?
Honestly, I'm not sure it favors one style more than the other, especially considering how scores were. I think it's just more about accuracy. I mean, if you're playing left to right, you obviously have to definitely get the ball going right. But if you're playing closer to the gutter, there's not a lot of room for error either. It tends to be Stephanie's A game, playing up the gutter, especially with the paradox in her hands. So I guess we'll kind of wait and see.
Yeah, she made a big run in the match play round. She kind of struggled her way through, but grinded and figured out a way to get into the top 12 with a late run, and then made her run in match play.
Yeah.
So players look like they've got the pocket pretty close. It seemed like when we started the tournament this week, it was going to be a score fest.
I would have to agree, especially after the practice session. I mean, even after talking to people, they thought it was going to be maybe even higher scoring than Wichita, but ended up being the exact opposite.
Yeah. What do you think attributed to that? Was it the way the players broke down the lanes, or was it just the fact of re-stripping and re-oiling and the pattern maybe playing truer as the week went on?
Probably a little bit of both, especially this house tends to have higher friction with the HPL lanes, so it hooks more in general, but it was almost like the three board was more of the gutter than the actual gutter itself on this pattern, so people might have gotten a little bit hesitant to play out there, so they ended up moving left even faster.
So no blood drawn early here. Did you like that nurse terminology there?
Absolutely.
Aaron is a nurse when she's not a super famous bowler. So you'll get to go home and take care of people for a few days, and then come back out and take care of yourself.
I'll go back and work tomorrow, Monday and Tuesday, and then hit the road again.
But what's that like? Is it tiring? Is it stressful? Do you look at the tour as kind of a release from your day-to-day life? Or how does that work?
I mean, it's a little bit stressful just because just the packing and the doing laundry and making sure I have everything taken care of before I take off again for bowling. But seeing all my friends out here on tour and just getting to hang out, it's kind of a release. I mean, when you're on the lanes, it's obviously like a job. It's competition. You want to do the best you can, but off the lanes, it's a lot of fun.
Does it help if you have a week out here where you maybe don't bowl well and get to go home and kind of forget about it, or is it the other way around?
Kind of both, because I want to go home and figure out where I went wrong. It happened to me in Wichita, actually, and I went straight from there to Nationals. Didn't bowl well at all, but came back out here kind of a little bit refreshed, and I obviously bowled better, so can work both ways.
So Rocio with the first open frame here of our group stepladder finals, and falls 15 pins back of April Ellis. Diana looking for the first double, trying to take an 11-pin lead over Stephanie Johnson. Boy, that was pretty close.
It was.
There's just not a lot of hold when you're going left to right, especially early.
No, definitely not. And if you can stay patient enough to get that double or triple, they'll come, but it's staying patient. That's the hardest part.
Garcia bounces back with a strike in the fourth. But now April Ellis is going to have a chance to extend her lead. So Diana's had a couple of really heartbreaking losses here on tour so far. She led qualifying in Sonoma, and she led qualifying last week in Wichita. And she was pretty bold with the statements she made after qualifying last week about how she wanted to win. And you know her probably better than anybody. How did she take it once she was eliminated from those events?
I mean, obviously not happy at all, especially when you bowl that well during qualifying and then during semifinals and you get to the match play and you got all those bonus spins, but she couldn't quite get there. But she actually helps me with my mental game more than, I mean, most people out here on tour. So she's fairly resilient in that aspect. I think she just kind of needs to get out of her own way, which she can do it. She's done it several times before. I think she just needs to do it once and get over that first hurdle.
Well, she's going to try to make the show from a different route this time, from the bottom of the stepladder.
Yes.
And Stefanie Johnson gets the first double of that match. And April Ellis trying to extend her lead with the turkey here in the fifth. Well, there's the no hold.
Oop.
Yeah, that was just left of left. And no chance of that one holding. April trying to play a lot further right than most of the other players all week. And it seemed to work pretty well early, but there still wasn't much hold if she missed that far left. It seemed like that was the other issue, too. If you played from that far left, It was hard because you had to use so much surface just to kind of calm the back end down. It seemed like there were a lot of flat tens, balls hitting dead on arrival.
Yeah,
right?
Very difficult to get the entry angle into the pocket, especially from the start if you weren't playing that straighter angle.
But on the other hand, what do you do? I mean, it's hard enough to hit the pocket, right?
It's kind of like a catch-22. I mean, do you take your spares or do you risk it and try to get that double or triple? I don't know. In these scenarios, I would just try to take the spares for now.
Yeah, yeah. Well, but this is stepladder, so obviously you got to take some risks, especially if your opponent is putting some pressure on you.
This is true.
So it looks like Diana's lined up, but Stefanie lined up as well, and she's going to need to start striking to get back in the match, and that was a pretty solid shot there. So how would you assess your first 6 weeks out here so far this season, Erin?
I feel like I've been on a roller coaster. Haven't really performed all that well. The Queens was okay. I felt kind of up down there as well. But this week was really my most, I guess, consistent week of how I was throwing the ball overall. I know my games didn't really show great consistency, but it at least felt better to me. And it's difficult going week to week, especially if you have a couple bad weeks in there.
Do you feel like you've bowled well enough to win this year, or has it been kind of matchup, or maybe you just haven't found something you've really loved all that much and you've kind of grinded your way through? How's it?
I think mentally I've been kind of down on myself, so it's hard to get in that rhythm and feel that like you can win an event if you can't even get yourself to the top 32. So
yeah,
I mean, this week was obviously better, and we'll try to take it into next week, but difficult when you only have those 2-3 days in between the stops to figure out what you've done wrong and what you can do better
right,
for that
right,
next time.
Right. Better shot there from April, but creeps high, leaves the 4-pin. So she'll have a 23-pin lead with a conversion in the 6th. And Stefanie Johnson shot there, but a 10-pin and with a conversion there. She'll lead by 8. But Diana's going to have a chance to get up in the 7th and take the lead. So you're planning on staying out bowling the rest of the stops on for the whole season?
Yeah, for the rest of the season, I'll be at all of them. So I rearranged my work schedule so that I could work and get to all of them.
Okay. I'm sure work is pretty flexible.
Yeah, it's we get to schedule ourselves, so that kind of helps matters. And then I have people that are willing to trade on the weekends, so pretty much working every holiday this year, but
yeah.
get to bowl all the stops. So.
Yeah, that's cool. I know you do, I heard last year you did some late shifts and then
yes.
had to come and bowl right after that.
Yes.
Well, that's not what she wanted, I'm sure.
Not at all.
Just if you miss right from in. I mean, if you can't miss left, you can't miss right.
Oh, there's very little misrim.
Big shot here for Restrepo, trying to cut into that lead of April Ellis. That was pretty good. Oh, just cut the head pin a little bit too much, and now Diana trails by 20. So when Diana loses, not saying that she's going to, but when she does, how long does it usually take her to get over it?
I mean, this year not very long. She'll pack up her stuff and put it away. Kind of just depends on how many people try to come up and talk to you right after you're done bowling.
Right.
Sometimes it's hard to just take those couple extra minutes by yourself.
Yeah, I was actually standing with her last week, and she had 300 bowled at her in the stepladder, which is pretty hard to beat.
Yes.
And apparently the person that came up to her wasn't watching who the woman who bowled 300 was bowling against and say, hey, did you see that 300 game? yeah, I did.
Yeah, that's
it eliminated me from the tournament, buddy.
That's never a good feeling. But it happens.
It does. So this match starting to get interesting on the right. April Ellis with the double. Rocio Restrepo with the turkey. And 13 pins separate those two players coming down in the 9th and 10th frame. Stefanie Johnson up 20 in the 8th frame over Diana Z. Not over yet, though.
Oh.
Especially on this pattern, you could easily throw a couple of big fours and could be a completely new match.
I can attest to that.
Nice shot there from April Ellis. Really going to put the pressure on Rocio Restrepo. Stefanie can do the same in our other match. Already up 20. The best Diana can shoot 207. Stefanie already on a 207 pace. Pretty close. I mean, how frustrating is that when it's this hard to hit the pocket, and then once you do, you're leaving shaker sevens and flat tens or ring tens?
Very frustrating, but like I said, you kind of just have to make your spares on this pattern and hope that you get those breaks every now and then, kind of like that.
Yeah, exactly like that. So now Rocio Restrepo can turn the tables a little bit. If she can go off the sheet, she'll shoot 234. April's on a 227 pace, so that means she would need the first hit in the 10th and 8 spare. Shot there from Rocio Restrepo. Now big shot here for Diana in the 9th. So Rocio Restrepo misses, and she'll shoot 222 with the conversion. Big shot here now for Diana. She balks again. That looked more like the garden variety balk that we've been seeing from her lately. But Rocio with 222 with the spare. And that means April Ellis will need a mark and good count to advance to the group stepladder final on her side of the bracket.
Come on. Yeah.
Oh!
Slow messenger.
Slow messenger. That was pretty huge. She doesn't strike there and the match is pretty much over. And as we mentioned, April just needs good count and mark. She'll need to spare that. And seven pins to advance. And Diana, big shot here, 11th frame. And that will put some pressure on Stefanie Johnson. Everyone watching at home, I mean, just how hard is it to, I mean, they're obviously not easy. We saw Diana the last couple of shots go miss the head pin and then through the nose, and then now you need a four bagger just to stay alive. I mean, what do you tell yourself?
I mean, you have to try and stay calm for starters, which is easier said than done. Sometimes your heart rate gets a little fast and you might amp up a shot and miss it, so that extra second, just take a deep breath and just try to hit what you're looking at. I mean, there's no miss room to the left or to the right, especially on fresh.
Sometimes you just have to make a good shot.
That's what it comes down to, and hope that all 10 fall at the same time.
So, clutch finish there for Diana Zavjalova, 207, and now Stefanie Johnson needs two strikes and a pin to advance. April Ellis will need seven on this shot to advance. And she gets it, so April Ellis advances to the group stepladder finals, final match, and Rocio Restrepo, a good week for her, but we'll see her next week. And now Stefanie Johnson actually has to have this strike to stay alive and gets it, so possibility of a tie here if Stefanie were to spare. We'd have a tie and a one ball roll off. Have you ever been in a one ball roll off before?
I have not.
No?
Oh. I don't think I'd want to be either.
So must strike to advance. Spares the tie. Open frame, she loses. Wow. Good break there just to get the 10 out, yeah. Not leave a washout. But not exactly a spare you want to shoot.
No, definitely not.
It's very easy to chop. What do? You just move right?
On this, I might move just a couple right, one or two right.
Yeah, because you don't want to fool around with left of your target, because that might just hook by the head pin, right?
Yes.
Yes, nicely done. Looks like she just moved five and five, right? That was kind of interesting.
In the right lane, if they should tie, we will continue in that manner. The left lane will go first, and then we will go until we break the tie.
right. Damon Sirocco, tournament director, explaining the procedure. Looks like Diana will lead off on the left lane.
I think Steph had a one-ball roll-off in one of the Queens matches as well.
Yeah, won that one, right?
Yes.
Yeah.
It went a couple frames, though.
Yeah, it's a pretty exciting format. I remember a few years back in PBA lore, Norm Duke and David Traber, I think, put seven shots on television. It's pretty exciting. Had some recent ones with Josh Blanchard and Tom Smallwood. And that's not a score that you want in a one-ball roll-off. It's like playing war in cards and throwing out a three.
It's not good count.
Yeah. So Stefanie Johnson just needs six pins, which ironically was the count she threw on her last strike attempt. So Stefanie Johnson advances to the group stepladder final.
Stefanie Johnson will advance. And our other match, April Ellis, has advanced. We'll bring our tournament, our tournament qualifiers over. They'll have a little bit of practice time on the championship there. How about a round of applause for Diana Zavjalova and Rocio Restrepo. Great ball, ladies. Fantastic tournament. Small break here to bring our number two qualifiers in for just a little bit of warm-up.
So another tough loss for Diana Z. Another solid week, but I'm sure you're going to have to be consoling her later today, huh?
We'll see.
Yeah. So Liz Johnson will come on, and she's going to take on Stefanie Johnson, battle of the rookie and players of the year from last season. Sandra Gongora, who bowled 300. Earlier this week, the only 300 of the tournament, will take on April Ellis. And have any predictions for us?
I'm not sure at this point. These could be some pretty good matches.
It's a prediction, I guess.
Right? I mean, Liz is gonna Liz is gonna play a little bit straighter out towards the gutter, like April was doing. I think Sandra might. I've seen Sandra play up the boards and hook it a little bit this weekend. So.
Yeah.
I'm not sure which way she'll take.
It looked like on that roll-off, Stefanie moved in a little deeper. Do you think she did that just to play safe and just kind of split the difference because she only needed six?
If I'm in that situation, I might, just because I know myself. But I don't know. I mean, she might have done that just to see what kind of look she has as well. So.
Yeah, because she knew she just needed five,
yeah.
Right? It's not... Well, I'm not going to say anything. Because I was going to say it's not that hard to get five, but sometimes it is. I mean, you'd much rather have to get six than a strike.
That's true.
Let's talk a little bit about Sandra Gongora. Get a lot of people who've never seen her bowl before, that know bowling, but don't know her in particular, and they see her throw it, and they say, "Wow, why doesn't she win every week?" And what's your assessment? Not that you know I'm setting you up to disparage her, but
I mean, I actually traveled with her to Topeka last year, and I don't think she bowled. I mean, she didn't bowl terrible last year, but definitely not up to what she wanted. And she told me that. She's just going to go home and work on quite a few things and then come out here. And I don't know. It says that she doesn't have her card online. I'm not sure if she does have her card. But she said she was going to bowl and see how it went the first couple stops and base the rest of the season off of that.
Yeah.
I feel like everything that she's just working on at home has really come together out here. She's more accurate. Her ball speed is actually a little bit lower. And she's been bowling well on every single pattern, consistently well. So I think the only one that... in Sonoma, I think she got bit by a spider, and that's
wow.
Really the only reason why I don't think she made the top 12 there. She
wow.
Had a lot of pain.
spider bite.
Yeah, it swelled up her entire elbow.
Wow.
She had to go to the ER at 2 in the morning, I think, for that one.
That's scary.
Yeah.
So, do they know what kind of spider it was? Was it a black widow?
I'm not sure. Okay. I'm petrified of spiders, so I didn't really want to ask too much info.
Yeah, that's kind of scary. Yeah, but she's so physically talented. You just watch her throw it and you say, wow, that's pretty good.
Absolutely.
And then she got off to a great start, of course, with the TV appearance in the Las Vegas Open. And has had a couple of good weeks to back that up, but looking for her second TV appearance of the season. Just needs one more win against April Ellis. So you've bowled on TV.
Yes.
What's that like?
I bowled on TV for the first time with a team, so that's obviously a little bit different than bowling individually. I mean, it's nerve-wracking, especially when I had to go against Liz Johnson, one of the best bowlers of all time.
Right.
But just the experience in itself is it's special. So 10 shots goes by, it feels like it goes by in 60 seconds.
Yeah.
So it kind of just...
You
looked
like
the experience.
Towards the end of your match, you were getting comfortable.
Yeah. I mean, I was comfortable during the practice session. I think that actually made me more nervous that I was so comfortable during the practice session. I tensed up and made some not-so-great shots and eventually got loose again when I knew that I couldn't win the match. So
That'll do it.
Just
yeah.
trying to throw decent shots.
Yeah. How about when you, I mean, because you made it at the Queens for your first individual professional TV appearance. And... you were in the winner's bracket and clinched a TV spot pretty early on compared to everybody else. What was going through your mind when you realized you clinched a spot in the TV finals?
I don't think it had actually hit me until maybe a day or two after that I had bowled that well.
Uh-huh.
I drilled the Delirium, which is obviously my all-time favorite ball now, and it just gave me a ball reaction that I hadn't had all week. It really made it, it was like an effortless bowling experience for me. I hadn't really felt that before. So, you know, I was just trying to make good shots and I had good ball reaction. I mean, the representatives from Ebonite were there and they were helping me whenever I got into a little bit of trouble, but it felt effortless bowling that well.
Yeah.
Especially that early on. So.
Yeah, I was there watching and you looked pretty relaxed for somebody who was making their first pro TV appearance. And I think you averaged something like 260 the last three rounds.
Yeah, I did.
That was very impressive.
To start the match on the left lane. Her practice is over.
And then you made another Stepladder finals here. It wasn't televised last
Correct.
Season. What was the difference between, because you've bowled in this environment
and in our other match,
before,
Sandra has chosen to have able
what's the
to
difference
the match
between
on the left
this and television?
I mean, the lights play a huge factor, especially how it affects the lanes, and then obviously you have the audience on both sides with you. So you've got all eyes on you, and you can actually see that rather than the being behind you.
Right.
Just a little bit, I don't know if I'd call it more relaxed, just different feeling when you're here versus actually in the lights on the camera.
Right, looks like we have the scoring.
Have
arrows
you spent
up.
A lot of time
we'll
thinking about strategy on television and in head-to-head matches?
Thank you,
honestly, I haven't thought much about the television portion just because I figured I'll deal with that once I get there. But I thought about how to, you know, get to these matches here.
Yeah. Well.
Just hasn't quite happened yet.
Well, we are about to get underway here. April Ellis taking on Sandra Gongora and Liz Johnson taking on Stefanie Johnson. Winners of these matches will advance as the numbers 3 and 4 seeds in the 2016 Pepsi PWBA Lincoln Open, which will be taped on CBS Sports Network on June 26th. And April, a little bit of an errant shot there to start the final match. And Liz with the split. When I drove up to the bowling center this morning at 6 a.m., I thought if they're like they were in the second round of qualifying, I like Liz Johnson's chances today.
I would have to agree with that, especially her last.
Oh! When she makes it spare, and now I like the chances even more. You were saying?
Her last match of the round of 12, she actually looked like she moved a little bit farther right than everybody else and had a really good look. I think she ended with 240 or so.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Found it interesting that we took video of Sandra's 300 and she bowled that the last game of the first qualifying round, and she was still pretty far to the right at the end of that qualifying round. It didn't seem like you were really able to play there in the second qualifying round by game six or even by game three.
Yeah. I think part of that has to do with her ball speed. She throws a little bit harder than most of the other females. I mean, her, Liz and Steph all throw it a lot harder than the rest of us. I think that allows them to play right a lot longer.
Mm-hmm. So after that impressive first shot, Sandra goes high and look out.
Wow.
Whiffs on the 10 pin. What is your first reaction when you miss a single pin?
It's kind of like a sinking feeling in your stomach, especially this early in the game. And I say you have to forget about it and just throw the next shot, but sometimes that's a lot easier said than done, especially in this format.
It's got to be probably the one thing that would irritate you the most, right, as a pro?
Yes, definitely.
Really don't have anybody to blame
but yourself.
Right. Can't blame the lane man for a missed 10 pin.
No, you can't. As much as some of us want to some days.
Liz Johnson, on the other hand, converts a split and parlays that into a strike in the next frame. It looks like she's pretty far to the right.
Yeah.
Yeah, Liz, when she can play out there and she can throw it hard, she can throw some messengers around.
She can be extremely hard to beat when she gets to play that particular line.
Yeah, she won in Detroit last year playing a similar line. Flying everywhere, stone nine, up for a second, gets tripped out, and we'll be in Detroit next week. Looking forward to that. I know they were really hard there last year.
Very. Yeah. That was probably the hardest stop. It actually made the U.S. Open feel easier than what it actually was.
Yeah.
Coming straight from there.
Yeah. I can't guarantee you they won't be that hard next week, but I don't know if they can be any harder than they were last year.
I don't think so, and if they are, that's going to be a little scary.
So looking forward to seeing Mark and Diane Voigt over there in Canton. And the event gets underway Thursday with some practice. Sandra misses back-to-back 10 pins. Wow.
You don't see that very often from her.
No, I consider her a good spare shooter. spare three bagger for the Johnsons. They're keeping up with each other. Isn't that an expression, keeping up with the Johnsons?
I'm not sure. It's not, it probably should be.
So Sandra bounces back after a couple of missed 10 pins. But now trails by 23 to April Ellis, and Liz Johnson with a four bagger. Takes a 10 pin lead over Stefanie. That's what's been kind of interesting about this pattern. You see the scores and it looks like the scores are low, and then all of a sudden you look up and a couple players have a six or seven bagger.
Yes. It seems to be a common theme throughout all of qualifying and even semifinals.
Like a pretty good shot there. I don't know if she just amped it up a little bit there. It didn't look like the direction was off by much.
On this pattern, even if your direction was good, it's not as forgiving as other patterns if you miss it even by just a little bit, or you clip it too much with your hand at the bottom. There's other patterns you have a little bit more room for error. Mm-hmm. Definitely not this weekend, though.
And sometimes, I mean, you, like yourself and all these players who are, I mean, you're pretty sharp at this point. You know when you missed it. You know when you threw it bad. But there's a lot of players that maybe come out and bowl, you know, as a guest, and they're not used to. Just explain how sometimes you think you threw a good shot, and it two pins on you. What do you do?
Sometimes it might take a frame or two to realize if it's really you or if it's the ball or your alignment with your feet. Sometimes just watching the veterans or the better players out here can give you an idea of where you should be playing the lanes or if you're playing them completely wrong. And then some people bring their coaches out here and you have the ball representatives that can assist you in that, because you can't always tell when it's you or if it's the ball. And
right.
I know I've struggled with that sometimes. You're two pinning or you're big fouring the next shot, and then you might think it's you, and really it's not. It's actually the ball or the lane. It just takes practice and time to figure out the differences between all of those.
Yeah, that's a really good point. Stefanie open in the sixth, and now the door is open for Liz Johnson. And in our other match, we had our third missed 10 pin. Now all of a sudden, if Sandra strikes here, she's in the lead. It's funny, when you can't make a spare, it seems like the bowling gods give you that spare.
Yep.
Just about every time.
They just know.
Oh, can't make a 10 pin? How about a 10 pin?
Got it that time.
All right, so despite the two missed 10 pins, Sandra Gongora just 9 pins down in the match. Liz Johnson has a chance to really put all kinds of pressure on Stefanie with another strike here in the seventh. And trips the four. And now Stefanie really in a must-strike situation. She can still shoot 244. Liz, if she can stay clean, would be in the 240s. Sandra's first TV appearance earlier this year. She made one of the automatic spots into the stepladder finals, which I'm sure is a big relief.
Yes, it always is when you get that automatic spot. It's like pressure's lifted off your shoulders for sure.
I'm not sure if she knew she had qualified when she made the show, and someone told her, and she kind of burst into tears. And were you there when that?
I don't think I was.
Okay.
When that happened.
Yeah, it was pretty cool. It was a pretty cool moment because I don't think she realized that she'd automatically qualified for a spot.
Probably even a better feeling.
Yeah, then. Yeah. Well, I think that's pretty much going to do it for Stephanie. Yeah. She really had to keep striking in order to stay alive. Now she'll need a lot of help from Liz. You never know, though.
It's true.
She makes the spare and takes it off the sheet. She could shoot 224. Liz would just need a mark in one of the last three frames. I hear the voice of Del Ballard quietly speaking to Sandra, giving her some advice. I think he said, next time you leave the 10 pin, I think you should make it. Seven bagger for Liz Johnson, and Liz will make another TV show. Took home the title in the Las Vegas Open that was seen on CBS Sports Network earlier this week. Boy, it's just one of those matches where you just got to hang in there.
Yeah, pretty much. No one wants to take it quite yet.
It seems like the left lane is the tougher of the two lanes on this pair. We've seen players miss both high and light.
Yes. Never a good sign.
Yeah.
Not quite sure where to go.
Yeah. Now, I'm not sure what to attribute it to, other than maybe it's just a tough lane. Someone's going to make a TV show in this match.
Just not sure who yet.
So 200 for Stephanie Johnson, and another good week for her. She just seems to be there week in and week out. Definitely, I think, the most consistent player on tour last season.
Yes.
But 260 is hard to beat, especially. Oh, another messenger. especially when it only takes 210 to make the show. 260 is a tough score to beat.
Yeah, those aren't very common scores from this past weekend, that's for sure.
Yeah. Well, she's not going to get 260, but she'll be in the 250s. And Liz Johnson will be in our opening match for the 2016 Pepsi PWBA Lincoln Open. And April Ellis,
big shot
in the ninth, sets herself up for the 10th. And that was big because now she can't be shut out. Ball strikes like that
sometimes.
I just love that strike where the ball just goes through the pins and it's almost like the pins don't even weigh anything, just
go straight back.
Yeah, it's fun to watch. All right, so 10th frame. Basically, whatever Sandra does here, April will have to match it to advance. Lucky to break up the split there. So spare and a strike, and April will need spare and eight to advance to TV. .176 for Sandra Gongora, and she still will have a chance, but will those two missed 10 pins cost her?
Yeah, unfortunately.
So spare an 8 is what April Ellis needs to advance to the televised finals to take on Liz Johnson. No gimme, though.
No, definitely not. Not on this pair, anyways.
Yeah. And April Ellis advances to the TV finals, her first career Professional Women's Bowling Association telecast. Great shot there for the strike. And you know that feeling.
It's a wonderful feeling. She actually, I was going to the bathroom right before this, and she told me that she was extremely nervous before coming out here and bowling these two matches. Said she had lost her spare game during the match play as well, but she only missed one spare these two games.
Well, she's going to have a couple weeks to figure it out again.
That's true.
She'll be appearing on television on CBS Sports Network. We're going to tape those shows June 26th in Green Bay. We'll have the live finals of the Go Bowling PWBA Players Championship that weekend. And Aaron McCarthy will be there.
Yes.
As will approximately 90 of the greatest women bowlers in the world. But April Ellis, this is a moment. Her first career PWBA TV finals appearance. And that's got to be a great thing, because that's the thing, you know, you can show your grandkids, right?
Absolutely.
You know, that's...
it's a moment you just don't forget.
fantastic bowling. All right, bowling fans, at this time, it's my pleasure to introduce to you your top four for your TV Stepladder Final. In the fourth position, by virtue of a win right here just now on 25 and 26, an All-American at Pikeville University, put your hands together for April Ellis. Her opponent in the opening match, 12 titles in all, 6 majors, 2 queens, 4 U.S. Women's Opens. The reigning player of the year from Cheektowaga, New York, Liz Johnson. The winner of that match will go on to face our number 2 seed. She has back-to-back AMF World Cup championships, 3 times a world champion, 3 PBA regional titles. From Pflugerville, Texas, please welcome Clara Guerrero. The winner of that match will go on to face our number 1 seed. She put on an exhibition this weekend. Fantastic bowling. 11 times a member of Team USA. Captured 12 times a member of Team USA. Captured her first singles PWBA title earlier this year. Please welcome Shannon O'Keefe. Bowling fans, these are your top 4 for our TV Stepladder Finals. One more round of applause for all of our competitors. Congratulations, ladies. Great bowling.
Well, it looks like a great show. The only way it could be better is if you were on it.
This is a good show. Maybe next week.
Maybe next week. Well, I really appreciate you spending some time with us here on Extra Frame, Aaron, and calling the match for us.
Thanks for having me.
Yep, it was a lot of fun. Good luck next week and for the rest of the season. And hopefully we'll see you out there next time and not back here.
Hopefully. Thank you. I appreciate it.
Yep. And save some lives this week and then
absolutely.
And then kill some pins next week. How about that?
Deal.
Okay. Very good. That's Aaron McCarthy, ladies and gentlemen. Nice enough to help us out here on Extra Frame. And what a great show we've got here for the 2016 Pepsi PWBA Lincoln Open Finals. There's some selfies going on out there. And the end of a great week here in Lincoln at Sun Valley Lanes. Proprietor John Lacido, thank you to him and all of his great staff. Fantastic event, great hospitality, and we had a great time bringing it to you here on Extra Frame. So, for Emil Williams Jr., who's out there doing some work, I am Jason Thomas, and we'll see you next week from Detroit here on Extra Frame. Have a great day.